esports, we are still at the beginning, and giving context to data was super complex. Technology and stats and insights can really help doing that.
It's a relatively small sample size, but the consensus on the desk after that last game, Chen, absolute god-tier pick. And to talk about all of that, we have Natas and Sin. So why is Chen just undeniably a great pick?
You got this.
I think it, number one, it helps when you have a hero like Wraith King that can play around his timings and that can apply tower pressure across the map. Number two, I think that 20-minute roast fight was just disastrous from Mineski. I think KP just took himself out of the game.
Yeah, let's start all the way back at the beginning, even before we even got to some of these fantastic moments that we are going to be looking at throughout all of these highlights. And let's talk about the draft in particular, because this was a draft that we really didn't expect on either side.
Yeah, that was a pretty cool moment.
That was a really fun moment that we just saw there. Roshan bashed the Spiritbreaker. I mean, there's plenty of question marks in this game for me. I personally don't think Doom is this high tier of a pick when you don't even have anything it counters at the point in time you choose the hero. They only saw a Chen, and then they went Grimstroke Doom, which, you know, historically has had good synergy with the Soulbind into double Doom. But the problem is when you don't know what matchups you're facing yet, you don't even know how useful Doom is going to be. And you just open up the door, hey, we're just going to pick Wraith King. He doesn't care that much about getting doomed. He has two lives. He can just frontline for us and not be too scared of getting caught out. And the other hero they picked in the second phase then was the Spirit Breaker. So they just like, just absolutely just run at them in these fights. And yeah, even though KP got pretty farmed, it didn't feel like that good of a Doom game, and which is hardly surprising after the hero has been nerfed and you pick it that early on. And as we mentioned, it's not really a flex pick to the same degree. Playing it four is very hard because you can't devour the big creeps anymore in the beginning. You give so much information away. And it's not.
Look at where he is, right? So KP, just before this fight, you saw he was sitting at three on the net worth chart. He and Moon go into the Roche pit here trying to make a play. KP buys back and dies here. Okay, and then dies again a minute later in his jungle. And look at where he is already on the net worth chart. His economy is just crippled, and he was barely in the top half of net worth distribution for the rest of the game.
Yeah, and we have to consider he, with the strategy that Mineski ran, he actually started alone in the offlane. They started three heroes safe lane, right, to try to give this Morphling a good start. So in spite of that, his farm was actually pretty good in this game for the Doom, but in the end, it still wasn't enough.
Also very significant, that TA fight two highlights before this one, when you saw in the top lane there, they were able to take down the Morphling without using Aegis on the TA, and that was why Complexity was then just able to take those top lane barracks at in the early 20s just completely for free with the Aegis still up.
Yeah. So I guess what we're getting at here, Rich, is that we still don't feel like Chen was the driving force behind this game.
Yeah,
He did his part and contributed. Don't get me wrong. I'm not going to be just denying everything he did. The healing, especially in fights, the sustain was really useful. The extra healing, the Hand of God, the early towers that they were able to take with him and Wraith King. I think it looked way better with Wraith King than with Juggernaut early today, so that's definitely a hint as to how to draft around this hero. But once again, it is also into Io, who has been heavily nerfed, did not look very strong this game at all.
Right.
And I wasn't too big a fan of the early Doom pick. Yeah, I still thought Mineski were going to win, but
in terms of revising my expectations, the biggest thing about this game was not the Chen. The biggest thing about this game, number one, was Wraith King continuing to climb in value. Just the kind of free pushing aspect offered by those skeletons, the durability overall of the hero, and What else was I gonna say there? God, I just lost the second thought. All right, say something.
It happens.
Yeah,
I gotcha.
Senior moment, man. Oh, damn it.
That was exactly what I was gonna say. Duo synergy forming. So I will say that as much as, you know, I said that Chen was a god-tier pick, I was joking around, of course. I knew you would get it. but as much as picking the Chen isn't necessarily a god-tier pick. I think the first thing that we started to talk about before we even saw the game, we said, this is an interesting draft all around. We have to keep in mind what the Chen is actually playing against before we try to assess this hero. But Nahas, what just popped back in your head?
The pop back to my head is the damage output of the Spirit Breaker, right? Especially with the Darkseer Surge second on top of it. The idea that Spirit Breaker in this game wasn't just a hero that you have this flying in, charge, disable. He was a hero that you fly in, you charge a hero, you get a bash, and all of a sudden that hero's at 2/3 health.
He actually was able to put so much pressure on both the Morphling and the Storm Spirit, who historically are pretty good against this hero because they can avoid the charge. You can waveform through it, or you can zip through it with Storm and not get caught. It's just, he's so fast.
Yes.
If he comes out of the tree line, you don't even get to react. Like, it's just, he's just there instantly. Right. You don't even get the time to move your mouse and click your spell before, you have half a second to react, not even.
Game two. We're about to get into it. Do we expect that the drafts are going to look anything like they looked like in game one?
I think the team that will change the most is Mineski. This just didn't really work for me. I don't think First Phase Doom is that great.
I don't think
Io looked too hot either, but they might just have had an off game and they can show it better in the next game. I think the tiering of the Io is about right. Like, you pick it in that phase. I still stand by that it's not a first phase pick right now. But I think
I'm not even sure it's a three pick. I think Io is one of those. If you see seven heroes already on board, I can maybe see taking out. I just think it's a difficult hero to make work right now.
Then it almost feels impossible to pick, because when do you have a support pick over on the eighth pick of the draft right now? It's pretty rare. It's not impossible, but it's
where you have these teams like NIP that use a lot of flex picks, moving things like Batrider to support. It's
doable,
possible,
but
right?
It's awkward then.
What are you writing? Oh, never mind.
He actually wrote something good for once.
He actually wrote Io Pod. Yeah.
No. He wrote Doom and Io third pick. He wrote it down.
Wow.
There.
What?
It's hard to see from over
there.
That's
not a meme? What? Really is this Rich Campbell?
Yeah, I wrote it right under Core Io Pog and Sind Lul and Chen. Okay. I know. I take serious notes. I do take serious notes. I wrote Tome Upgrade, Tri Lanes. I wrote DX Racer is the most comfortable chair on the market. It's like sitting in a throne. I can't imagine using a computer without NVIDIA, and all stats that aren't created by SAP are completely useless, non-mathematical garbage. And
now we're fighting. Okay.
There we go. So I do want to talk about, if we see changes, what do we expect that those changes will be? Because we keep talking about how these were completely unexpected, right? Seeing these hero picks come out when they came out and in the first place caught us a little bit off guard. What do you expect Mineski to potentially move towards?
I'd like to see Mineski move back to a lineup where they're dictating the fights, where they're starting the fights. I mean, the Grimstroke Doom open felt very passive in this game, especially when you look at the heroes that get picked up in the second phase, subsequently by Complexity in the Darksphere and the Spiritbreaker. You look at Wraith King not caring about getting doomed. Mm-hmm. I think some of Sin's comments there were very on point. Mineski is a team, you look back to, again, different personnel, but you look back to when they were playing really well last year, and it was around these strats like Puck Venge, where they were starting fights, where they had these combinations that were repositioning the enemy team.
Yeah.
And I don't think Doom Grimstroke is that kind of a mold.
I'm just thinking, if they've watched the rest of the games of the tournament so far, either they really believe in Doom as the only team that's played so far, or I'm just confused as to why they wouldn't just Grim Wraith King right there. When there's a first pick Chen, why don't you take the Wraith King away from the Chen that, you know, it's not rocket science why it works. And we even talked about it in the previous Chen game that we've had in this tournament, that he would be good with a carry like Wraith King. When presented with the option, I'm just a bit confused why they rate Doom this highly.
Because Doom's probably not getting banned either. That's the other thing. He's going to be there in the second phase if you want him.
I think so too. Maybe they're a little bit behind the eight ball here, or they just, you know, it's also possible they just had a bad game. Like, maybe we would be having a different conversation if they just showcased this Doom a little bit better.
That's the other thing, is that I don't want to talk too much about the draft. When they had a 3K or so net worth lead going into that 20-minute Roche fight and were looking pretty good, you know, Storm was looking, all three cores look like they were having a game. And it's just very difficult when your Doom, who goes into that fight, the third most farm here on the map, just, he kind of takes himself out of the game economy-wise. Yeah.
I do want to ask right now, I feel like we can finally ask this. We've seen every team now that is going to be competing in this minor. We finally have. That last game did just that. Do we feel like there is a flavor as far as the meta is concerned? Are there certain heroes that are really defining what we expect games to look like, Sind?
I feel like even after the first three or four games yesterday, even at that point, it was clear that the teams are really looking for this 5-on-5 team fight in the mid game, either with big cooldowns or heroes that can non-stop fight. Those were the two different styles we saw. One example is the Spirit Breaker Darkseer that is just like, let's go, let's go, let's go. And the other one is the Grimstroke Warlock, right? Which is, okay, let's not go all the time, but when we go hard.
Right.
The fights are happening a lot, and that's why I think that's another problem with Doom, right? Like, it's a long cooldown ultimate. When you don't have the Doom, how much do you contribute in a fight? Whereas, for example, Warlock, at least you have Fatal Bonds, mm-hmm. which seems to do a lot, right?
Seems to, yeah.
yeah, it does a lot.
I think we can say that one works.
So, you know, maybe that's also why Wraith King feels so good, because once you hit level 12, and especially level 18, Wraith King is just, the ultimate cooldown is so negligible that you right. feel like you have it all the time. And even in the early game, well, if you do play against any lineup in the enemy team that has big cooldowns, you kind of negate them in a sense by having that Wraith King with the two lives, right? So I just think we're going to see more Wraith King, we're going to see more stuns, and we're going to see more team fights around the mid game that where heroes just aim to peak between minute 15 to 25. There's just so much happening in these games.
Right? I think we're going to see, and this is a continuation of a trend that you saw a lot of in the last patch, we're just going to see a lot of these lineups that are built around taking the one or two big fights in that critical 25 to 35 minute range and just being able to end the game off those fights. You know, the concept of leverage, right? Being able to take a one fight and convert that into a big resource advantage. It's also interesting to me with the nerfs to Siege Creeps, with the nerfs to Chenzo early game, et cetera, teams are having to be a little bit more creative to generate early tower pressure.
Yes,
you know, we saw Adam do a really good job at taking that mid tier one tower solo around the 12 minute mark in that last game. Morphling got an early tier one tower top against a pretty difficult Darkseer Spirit Breaker lane. I think teams are going to be placing more and more priority on that.
I definitely, there's two sides to the Chen push mid though. At the same time, you feel like Mineski should not be dropping a mid tower like that
Agreed.
To a Chen. That tower needs to be defended.
There you go. This is more what I expected to see out of Mineski in game one. Both those picks, it's just much more solid open.
Chen got banned this time around, so Mineski respect that after game one, as we have established on this panel.
And the Spirit
Breaker is absolutely insanely good, just unmatched, the best hero in the game. as for
beautiful, big true.
Complexity, all right, yeah. They get
that's
the
a lot of information instead, though so. That you give away. That the problem with this open is you now know Sand that is going to be a Z Freak Sand King and a Tavo Darkseer. There's no flux value left in either of those two heroes, and that's a big part of why you talk about first phasing either of them. Radiant team back.
Mineski's turn to back. I don't know. I'm not sure if I like this from Call. It's like these two heroes are really high tier picks right now, it seems, in this tournament, both of them. But showing them together, I agree, is a little bit. For Sand King has some weaknesses because, you know, when you play the hero's position 3, it's more or less a given that you will get the Veil Blink or the Vessel Blink.
Right.
But if you play position 4 and the lane does not go well, Sand King's recovery curve, it takes a bit of time, and you kind of have to max Sandstorm as a support, which gives you pretty poor reach, making your stun relatively weak, and giving the enemy team, like we talk about these timings, right? If Sand King is out there farming a dagger as position 4 or whatever, first of all, his damage output is way lower than a position 3 Sand King would be. And if your 4 isn't making moves and your 3 is a Darkseer, you do open up opportunities for the enemy team to make plays. Oh, this is very interesting.
Wow.
This hero, okay.
So wait a minute. What role is Pango in this game?
Oh, man, I really don't like this entry pick.
It's so weird.
I don't like it at all. So I've seen multiple teams in the past months, there's been Enchantress as counter picks for Darkseer, just because when Darkseer tries to skip waves, Enchantress can always remove the iron shell he has on himself and just hit him nonstop with no risk. The downside is you can't enchant the creeps that he puts iron shell on, because effectively, sure, you stop his push, but you also lose your carry experience every time you convert these creeps. I remember one game seeing it run for the first time, they just shot themselves so hard that they kept converting the iron shell creeps and they lost the lane by taking over creeps. They got out leveled.
It's one of those things that when you start talking about those kinds of dynamics and very specific hero counters, I think that's fine if it's a 5-position enchantress. It's not a 5-position enchantress in this game, more than likely. Warlocks
wouldn't
are 5.
Think so, yeah.
Right, so
it's core.
That's what I'm asking is.
Probably.
I was gonna, before Enchantress got picked, I was gonna ask you, do you still think mid Pango is viable?
It can be. It definitely can be.
Okay.
I don't know if Moon even plays it though.
But this is. I just. After this, these These third picks have changed my assessment of this draft a lot. I just now think this complexity draft is much more stable.
I mean, also, they're not really breaking the mold here. I mean, look at what we're actually seeing. I mean, you look at Leshrac, you look at Sand. Like, we're seeing these heroes over and over again, and I feel like complexity, they can just play it by the books here. Mineski's somewhat gaming themselves.
Yeah.
I think it's on Mineski right now to find a way of setting up fights. They have extremely good follow-up in both Pango and Warlock, but those heroes are not going to start it for you, and Ench isn't either. That's why I was looking for maybe an offlane hero that could get them going and get in on these heroes so the fight can start.
Are they thinking about like a Spectre here? Is that the play? Are they? Are you going to go with the Fatal Bonds Dispersion idea again? But I just don't. Your lanes are looking pretty damn weak too.
If you get Spectre, I think your safe lane enables Sand King, basically.
Okay.
Then your safe lane will be, unless you do something creative with your lanes, like Warlock Spectre will let Darkseer Sand King free farm.
Yes, exactly.
They'll push the wave.
Exactly. It's not going to get much in response.
No, they can just go stack camp. Sand King can farm it with Sandstorm and Ion Shell, very easily get all the gold he needs to get his key items up. So, I mean, it is possible they go that route, but I kind of don't really like it. And again, I don't think it solves the problems that they have at all. I just see them getting run over in the early mid game with only having this one gimmick of landing Fatal Bonds Haunt and then Dispersion and hoping that Pango lands a good combo. But again, how do they set up a fight that has good conditions for them?
I don't see it. I really don't.
There has to be something coming up here that starts the fight for them.
Yeah.
Oh, KP seems pretty excited. I guess he loves playing Enchantress. Does he love winning, though?
That's always the question, right?
All right.
You damn well hope so.
I do want to ask, since we've seen the Disco Pony so much, actually, here we go.
Okay, there we go. Good.
Okay,
good.
Ember Spirit. Is this enough
good?
For you?
Question mark?
It's good because it has a way of starting. It's a catch,
not,
right? It's a way of
not,
setting something
not
up.
Good. Not good.
Okay. I'm not looking at the left draft right now. I'm looking at Mineski. No, listen. So I'm looking,
all right,
at Mineski's draft, and I'm looking at what do they need. They need some sort of way of catching heroes so something can happen that can set up Pango and Warlock for a successful fight. And they need something that uses Fatal Bonds to deal damage. And Ember checks both boxes, so that's nice. The problem is, they don't know what his matchup is yet, and now there's an Ursa pick coming out. I think this Ursa wants to lane either against Ember or...
Yeah.
Enchantress is a little bit weird because...
Ember or Pango, right? I mean, if Pango's gonna be a core...
I think Pango's four.
I don't know, that's kind of the problem is that, yeah, you if Pango's four and Ench is core, fine. But, I mean, what you need right now as Mineski is not to get eaten by a bear. And yeah. Ember gets eaten by a bear.
Yeah, that lane
big
is not,
time.
That lane's not good. But obviously Ember has the possibility of playing safe lane with Warlock. So it's a flex pick 1-2. So you can avoid the Ursa lane.
But it's just the problem, right, is that I mean what Lesh can play mid super easily too. Mm-hmm. So what prevents them complexity from just chasing them around the map?
If they get all lanes right, I think it looks good for Call still. But I still think even if Mineski lose two lanes out of three, as long as they don't get absolutely stomped in both, I think Ember is still the kind of hero they needed.
All right, fair enough.
It's fair enough if you don't like it, but I'm just thinking, like, what's better? I think Spectre would absolutely have been worse. Like, they needed something that...
The other thing that I really love here is that I feel like the fifth pick for complexity is significantly more open. Because I feel like either you could do something crazy like slide the Sand King back to five, put Leshrac or Ursa four or something and pick a core. You could also go safe and pick a five position hero for Adam.
They're going to bet Medusa. I don't know if they needed to do that. It's pretty good though, but.
Yeah, and this is, you can see Mineski thinking hard about those lanes, worrying, yeah, we're going to ban Monkey King because that's two lanes that Ember absolutely couldn't play in.
Yeah.
Man, I was really excited. Like, there's the potential in this one that it's the last game of the day, right?
Yeah.
I was going to try to call the last pick, but I don't think I have any idea with this one.
Well, the safe money's on an Adam hero. Yeah, there you go. That's really good. That's really good. Because the other thing is they could still pick it against you.
So we are expecting a mid-lash side lane Ursa, side lane Darkseer, support Oracle Sand King. It's really stable.
I'm expecting them literally to just chase Ember around the map with Ursa. Right? Whatever lane Ember's in, you're going to try and get Ursa matched up.
I'm not sure how bad the Ember against Leshrac matchup is, actually.
It's not great, but it's not a nightmare.
You can dodge Split Earth pretty consistently mm-hmm. with Sleight of Fist if you're paying attention, so it might not be that bad for Ember. It's still Leshrac favored, probably, yes. But not by like a ridiculous amount. The reason I'm saying that is that
that's what really worries me about this is that you're trying to get an Ember versus Lesh Lane where you're at a disadvantage rather than just getting your face eaten. So this is going to be TA mid. I don't know. TA Leshrac still. Like, I think Lesh can do just fine.
My big question again for Maneski. This feels like the kind of game where Ember needs to do a lot, and now he doesn't even have levels because he's not going mid.
Yeah. So what and he's gonna have to face Earth? Like what is this, Maneski? What?
I'm not sure about
this one.
What
are you trying to
do? Not that I'm not sure about this one. What I don't mean is that I'm not sure which team I favor. I'm not sure exactly what it is Mineski's going for. I don't see.
Yeah,
it.
I just don't. That's what's bothering me is that I don't understand this draft concept. Like no, what?
I don't get it.
What is strong here against the five heroes of complexity?
Yeah.
There's something I'm not seeing.
I'm a bit confused here.
I'll be completely honest. I shouldn't look at a draft and feel very strongly that it's a mistake. I should never feel that confident that a draft
should
a
never
mistake.
Feel anything.
And I don't see this one. That's a little bit scary. Yeah. And you know me, I'm a guy that only trusts the numbers, and I have the best, and they have been provided by our analytical partner in SAP throughout the entire tournament. So we're going to be talking about them when we return. But there's one number that's in my mind right now. Throughout the entire tournament thus far, every single series has gone the distance. We have gone to game three every time in this best of three format. That might change right now. Do we have our first 2-0 on our hands? We're about to find out.
I thought it was Kyle's phone number.
Well, Syndrome, we know Carl's phone number is kept secret and under wraps because it is highly sought after. But this could be a 2-0. This really could be a 2-0.
I think it could. If there was a series to do it, it would be this one.
Yeah, the draft looks real good for complexity. And maybe we don't start there. Maybe we start with Maneski. They've gone for the Warlock. They've gone for their combination. A lot of their heroes do sync with the Warlock, but what's the overall plan that they're looking at? Like when the coach walks off the stage and says, "You know what, guys, we're gonna win, and this is how we're gonna win." What's that? What's that communication?
Play around your team fighting. Well, TA gets ahead. You're able to deal with complexity's aggression.
Mm-hmm.
My concern is I look at the Cole lineup and I don't see anything that. You look at Maneski. Sorry. Complexity has tools to deal with everything they've got.
Yep.
You've got the Oracle, can cleanse off the Fatal Bonds. Eventually, Darkseer gets Greaves. Ursa Alt does the same.
Yep.
You have a full, like, all-in lineup. And Tavo's Darkseer is his best hero. I'm just shocked he got it again. Now they're even going to get Vision of this ward thanks to this early five-man smoke. And Moon, he's going to maybe break it. He does
indeed.
Yeah,
he breaks everybody.
Yeah, but it's just concerning because it's the same with Moon.
Oh,
where
they're going to get the Observer Ward as well.
They give it to Z-Freak so he can get boots faster, buys another Sentry. It's just tough because Moon, you have Ion Shell. There's the Leshrac Edict. There's so many methods of dealing with the Refraction. It's like the BKB timing that he needs before he can actually stand in these fights. Mm-hmm. And there's no real save on Maneski like the Oracle of Cole.
That's actually KP playing the Warlock as well.
Wait, what?
It's KP on Warlock. Because at the end of the draft, I said to you, like I actually said halfway through the draft, like, you know what, KB may play the Enchantress. It's something he's not unfamiliar with. He knows how to do this. You can play that DPS that we also saw earlier today. But so he's actually playing a three-position Warlock.
I've seen this before. I remember Zach actually telling me about they were scrimming, I think it was somebody in Mumbai, and they went for this Ench support. Oh, hang on.
Yeah,
top.
He went sleight of fist to begin with, and... Z-Free's going to stay on top of him. It costs him nothing just to keep walking up.
But it means he has slight level one.
Yeah. There's no protection for this Ember.
And look, this is what you do. And Ninja Boogie's going to come up here, and I think he'll... Okay.
Yeah, what does he do?
You do that. So you remove the Ion Shell. That's the whole point, mm-hmm. is that you just remove the Ion Shell. The concern that I have is... Does that matter? Because eventually you're going to have two heroes on. You can only get rid of the one, and then you're a hero with like 500 HP. Mm-hmm. And into the mid game, there's so much magic damage, and there's so much pace that complexity can play with.
It's also very interesting to see that 343 is committing a lot of time just to ensure that Moon's not going to have the easiest start. in the mid lane. This does leave Ursa in a bit of a solo role on the bottom, but now he rotates off. So just trying to change the balance of the mid lane first, yep. and then help the Ursa to get his farm.
It's because TA needs to win the first couple waves to dominate the Lesh. If Lesh can do all right until level 3, it becomes even because you just start spamming. You get a bottle and you push out the wave.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, before the whole fight began, like we're talking through the Warlock thing and how that's meant to work as a 3 position.
I mean, theoretically, it's a great hero, right? You have excellent talents. You love levels. You're one of the more level-dependent heroes in Dota 2. And maybe they just felt like if it was support, it would just get ran at. It makes sense because something that they lacked in the previous game was that aura hero item, or aura item hero.
Yeah.
Theoretically, that could have been the Pango, but it just does seem better suited to be a 4.
Yeah.
I honestly don't know. We haven't seen it before for a reason, right? And Moon now taking a ton of edict damage mid.
Maybe they also thought Limp. Oh, don't you're taking damage from the tower. You need to change that off real quick. Oh. The last attack, Limp. Careful.
Yeah.
That tower did not switch aggro.
Got a little distracted because of the
courier.
Yeah, he'll lose some CS for that. Unfortunately, 2 denies. And now,
and he gets hit by the Hadouken creep. Yeah. It's just interesting. Maybe they also thought Enchantress needed to have more of an influence across the map. You can't do that by putting her in a 3 role.
I will say, though, this is looking good for Mineski so far. We've seen this a lot. Whenever you see a Dark Seer, the enemy safe lane are often free farms. Ember Spirit, one of the better heroes in this game to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And the harass, my god, from...
Yeah, they're coming again. Slide of Assyrian Chase. It's actually going to be first blood. Z-Freak, he's down. Has he got another blast? One more attack. Ninja Boogie was able to see him, and Z-Freak goes.
He got one. He was just in time to buy his boots before he went down, so he'll have those as he TPs back up. But yeah, I mean, this is cool because you have Ajit with the free game now, already level 4, and mid lane, TA's winning. You're winning all your lanes if you're Mineski, and if there's a way to win games of Dota, that's it.
Yeah, win all 3 lanes, then you can win the game of Dota. Sure, why not?
And Complexity, we saw what they just did in that first game. They want to do the exact same thing here. Get ahead, stay ahead, rush around the map, and just kill Mineski's squishy heroes over and over.
It's kind of funny, too, because it always seems to be this combination that you give to Z-Freak. I'm just going to take a big, strengthy core as a support that's able to almost function as a core. Just surge him in, iron shell him up, close the distance, and have a stun when you do so.
Less
global because obviously it's Burrow Strike versus Charge.
Dude, Ninja Boogie, it's so good to have this hard camp. I'm surprised they didn't block it on Complexity because not only is the Satter great, but then you get this Mana Burn creep and he just spams it on Tavo and Z-Freak and they're no longer able to play aggressive in the lane. It's 100 Mana Burn on an 18-second cooldown. Very effective at zoning and it allows you to play on this one-on-two situation and actually out-duel the combination.
Mm-hmm. Ninja Boogie does still need some levels. He's still a level 1 Enchantress, and 1/3 of that level 1. Because he just can't stand in the lane. That means all of it is going the way of the Ember.
Yeah, that's perfect. It's solo XP on one of the most level-dependent cores in Dota 2. It is a dream for Mineski, and it gives them that playmaker they were missing in the first game, where it was much more about team fighting.
Mid lane, Burrow Strike comes in. Limp's going to have the follow-up stun, try and chain it perfectly with the Edict to burn through the refraction charges, but that one creep seeing a little bit too close. Moon's buying some time to actually kill Z-Freak. He'll still lose his life to Limp, however.
That was Limp's mistake. He waited to stun and then actually stunned the refraction, so he wasn't able to get any damage off it, thus he was able to turn around for a counter kill.
Man.
Top lane, that's the Enchantress. You purge off the Surge as well.
And that is lower cooldown as well, right? So it's even more frequent. That came recently.
And the bottom, you can see the Pango though against Ursa. This is a matchup I forgot about. As the game continues, a 5-second disarm is no laughing matter. No longer silences, so it'll almost always disarm on the swashbuckle. Plus, you have the ability to get away from the Ursa. Limp's coming in. Then that's the downside of the Enchantress. You die real fast to these heroes.
Yeah, Lushrak doesn't need to actually hit you. Miracle, disarm, making it impossible to get the hit into KP to finish the job. It means Ragey Potato will cop a lot of damage himself. It's for the 5-minute shrine, and that's why you're seeing Miracle committing in. He needs 2 more hits to kill off. He's going for both of them. Miracle, still under the tower, will end up falling down. Raging Potato get the solo experience for it. I don't know if you're really happy trading your 1 for your 3-ish.
A third Satter camp for Ninja Boogie up top. This is the dream. Mid lane, hard free farm by Moon. This is the TA advantage. I think TA Wraith King after this tournament are going to jump up a couple tiers in most meta, not predictions, but just
priorities.
Yeah, exactly. Because it's just, there's so much damage. They press towers, they farm really efficiently, and it just feels like too good, too strong, specifically the TA in the laning phase.
And you just prepped that with three swipes, swashbuckle away, but Oracle stuck with you.
Yeah. Ajit, though, already level 6, nearly 7, whereas the top lane of Complexity are both level 4 and 3. That's actually insane. Like, Ajit is having the greatest game, and he's even skipped Flame Guard, which makes his hero even more valuable at this point in the game, because he can play so aggressive.
He's also, like, keeping his distance, right? Like,
yeah. You don't have to even be in the face of the Ion Shells.
And that's the kiting. Like, that's Ursa being controlled. It's Limp unable to move forward and get that big damage output that he wants by staying on top of the enemy hero.
Yep.
KP out way too far. Easy pickup. This is the Observer Ward that knows that he's alone.
Yep, but that's the one thing that Kolab going through right now. Bottom lane, Miracle Ursa is crushing one of his signatures. And there isn't much Mineski have to deal with it other than the TA later on. Obviously, the disarm from Panga will be annoying. You do have a lot of disables, but you know, at the end of the day, Miracle with an Ion Shell and a Surge forwards, like, you're going to need to flee. Nobody can go toe-to-toe with him, and that's the...
They're going after Tavo. Spirit forward with the Searing Change into Boogie is there. He's got the Hadouken flying in. It will connect, but Tavo has just enough life. That Courier is saying, please attack me and allow Limp to go more further in. He needs the stun. He got it onto Ninja Boogie. The Pulse Nova will burn through him and then move on to Ajit. Still Spirits available, but won't be required to use them.
Surprised they didn't look to go for the Ember there, even just to apply some pressure.
He only would have one Spirit. What the hell was that Curry doing? It feels like they're trying to get him to turn around.
Yeah.
But it's probably just Miss Micro at the end of the day. Rotation around under the cover of smoke. Limp and Z-Freak looking to keep that momentum going. Especially if they can get a kill on mid, but they won't find mid. They'll find Ninja Boogie. Welcome on back, Enchantress. No. Another Burrow Strike and more damage, and this will be yet another kill for Limp, making his fourth out of the 7 of Complexity.
And level of 4 points in Edict now. It's huge. Means that he'll be able to apply tons of tower pressure and Complexity. It's important that they're able to get that done. It's a similar concept to the previous game. Play around mobility and their ability to stay on map. All next to no long cooldowns on the squad. They just want to get aggressive and do exactly this. Yep. Make rotations, pressure towers, make Mineski react to them instead of being able to set up those big team fights with Pango and Warlock.
Yeah, forcing fortifications so hard. Z-Freak still skipping around the back lines. Raging Potato and Moon will have to defend together.
A Javelin already. No boots. Orb of Venom Javelin on Raging Potato.
Sure. And Z-Freak's taking their camps. Darkseer is still getting his own farm up on top. He came close to death just previously, but at least ensuring that Ember Spirit's not adding any pressure towards the tower. That is where Ember does not really work. He cleans up the wave, but it doesn't attack directly into tier ones. Nowhere near as effective as like Lashrak, because he's just the king of that. Moon, nice meld dodge, easy. There they go. Spirit jump him. A little bit too far around, and the board time for Ninja Boogie to come in with one stun, two stun. Do that math.
Yeah, but you gotta look for Ajit to get more involved. I think I'm surprised he didn't go for a bottle, so he doesn't have that much mana sustain. I'd like to see him play with his teleport more. You can get so aggressive on Complexity's next movement. You want to ensure they don't get any free towers. And that's exactly what Cole are gonna look to do here as they continue to rotate around the map.
They're just sitting on top of that triple stack of Ancients. Yeah. Like, it's... How long until someone does want to commit? How long until the TA needs to move up? And TA, when he Psyblade attacked, denied the ward, it had actually hit Z-Freak up the hill, letting him know that, like, someone was up there at least. And here we go again from Mineski. One dive is never enough. This time Tavo's a little bit shallower. That one creep is able to stay alive with the Iron Shell, so he's happy for that.
And Ajit did buy a bottle, as I'd hoped, because he wants to be able to stay on map. He's got to be the playmaker. And you're the guy that's going to counter-initiate. And Complexity is definitely going to look to initiate.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. This might be an engagement top. It's difficult, though, for Mineski. The real lack of natural tower push. Sure, KP and Raging Potato are here, so you can secure the tower. It's just going to take a while. In Complexity, you can get a trade-off much easier because you just have to pop Edict.
Meanwhile, in mid, Templar Assassin looks like she's the next primary target. You fly full, but Moon, it's so hard to lock him down unless Z-Freak can close the distance. Without Darkseer giving that initiation, that speed forward, it just seems so hard.
Remember, Miracle took the bottom tower by himself. Mineski, you're still top trying to take it.
He's copped so much damage. Oracle does have the save, but they have to back up. KP gets the Fatal Bonds off. There's your double slide of Fist Searing Chain. Yep. And they just break Z Freak free instantly.
Exactly. And everything on Mineski, almost all their damage except for the meld, is dispellable. And that's the danger of the lineup, where if you can't get on top of 3-4-3, I don't see how you win fights. They need the Ember Spirit to be able to do that, the Pangolier to roll forwards. But the problem they have is that I feel like they're team fight based, whereas Complexity, they love playing just fast around the map. They're just going to run at you.
Tavert on the run back out. Ajit, it was so smart of him. He started with the Slide of Fist, did not burn the Searing Chain, so he could still get the control of Tavert when he tried to run out. And now, another Slide of Fist trying to dodge, but Miracles arrived. The Centaur stun buys the time for the Defensive Spirit jump away.
And look, all of a sudden, four heroes in Complexity up top. Z-Freak just trying to farm middle. Has level 7 now, maxed out Sandstorm. He'll just go to the offlane.
Strike up. Mineski going to try and fight this. And, well, Miracle already saying hello for a moment. Enchanted up. No extra swings for him, but Raging Potato. He's got Rolling Thunder. He's got Swashbuckle. We'll get him inside the pit. And away to safety.
No boots still. But Miracle's given up. He knows he can roll away if necessary.
The stack has started.
Z-Freak's just trying to camp it. Won't be able to do anything about it, though. Only a triple stack, though, for Moon. And it's also being taken 3 minutes later than Limp was able to do his in the previous game.
Well, Z-Freak, you think you could take one of these?
I'm just trying to be annoying. Not much going on now. You can see, though, Cole constantly poking and prodding, trying to find an area of the map where they can get aggro. Roll forwards from Raging Potato. A bit careful, but as you can see, Miracle immediately going to get cleansed off.
And he's really preparing for the late game. Hannah Midas, Ursa, after having the drums, phase boots. Attack speed or not, Yule Scepter from Limp will at least allow his initiation. And they're giving a lot of space to Z-Freak, like trying to ensure this. Well, is it going to be Blink Dagger you want to see over on the SK to begin with, get him to the front lines, or is there something else a little bit more critical? I don't know if you're like getting into the back lines of Mineski is easy enough with a blink.
I don't think it's necessary. I feel like Cole's confident that they'll be able to scale just because of the matchup Oracle has against the Mineski lineup, where both Ember and Warlock are heavily punished by the cleanse. Also, just so people are aware, the mechanic that Enchantress and Oracle have in this game is dispel, right? They both dispel. A purge is an offensive dispel, whereas cleanse is a defensive dispel. This is terminology that every player uses, at least is aware of. So please don't tweet at me.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you for the dictionary.
No problem. That's what I'm here for.
Nice Dire Observe Warden Sentry, seeing Complexity shrining up and getting ready for their own fight. And that was really paying dividends. You'll even see the smoke. So Mineski, they're already beginning to back up. There are two, maybe, that hasn't backed up the whole way.
The Surge.
Underneath the Tier 1 tower, Miracle just runs forward. He breaks free with the Enrage, goes for KP. Rock will drop down. Miracle being body blocked up by the Golem, so he couldn't keep the chase going. And the double disarm into Limp and 3-4-3. So Rolling Thunder, the Fatal Bonds kick them so hard. Complex that they have to retreat. Tavo back under the T1 tower. Spirit jump forward. No, Arjit are holding it for the moment. He'll get the side of Fist Searing Chains over on two. The jump forward. Here comes from Raging Potato. Another disarm. This one's on the Sand King, but he's in a little bit too deep under the Pulse Over of Limb through the Fog of War.
Whoa, able to connect to Moon.
He's in so deep going up to Miracle. The Fire Strike buying the time. Miracle's going to go down. The Spirit jump back up, but he's underneath the T1 tower. And thanks to Z-Freak's movement speed, they won't find Arjit straight away. They're looking to kill off the Golem that's taking the T1 tower. They're able to do so, which will mean a denial of the Tier 1 tower. And Mineski need to pull out. That was way too deep. Yeah. Too early.
That was a 4-on-5, though. Ninja Boogie was top. He'll actually take out that Tier 1. The Nanai hurts, but still an even split. Concern I have for Mineski is that... we'll see. There's a Midas rush on KP. He's already picked it up, even though he's only level 7. So he'll scale. Raging Potato with the Javelin. He's already level 7. He'll scale.
Just run at him.
Yeah.
He doesn't have the Yule Scepter yet, but with this kill, he'll have the money for it.
I love the decision to go Phase Boots here, just because it helps his early laning phase. And to have that little bit of armor, plus 6, negates the TA's ability to just crush you with the physical damage. The Slight, as well, will do a ton if you're going that typical, like, Arcane's Yule's Rush on Lash. You're just too squishy. There was a Blink Rush on Moon as well. Same style as Limp. Did come out a bit later. And really over-blinking in that previous engagement leading to his death. Otherwise, it would have been a much better fight for Mineski, and they probably secured the last hit on the tower.
And now they got to worry about their own tier one tower. I feel like this tower's been fortified three times now to protect it. Well, it's because the two side lanes went down, hence the refresh up. Yule Scepter is now over on Limp. Moon jumps forward. Limp wants to actually use the Yule Scepter aggressively on the Templar Assassin, able to connect over on the stun, but now he's in trouble. Rooted up, they'll try and break him free with the False Promise. Extra life needs to be given. They've done a lot already, and where's this heal? It's not coming fast enough. Limp will not be able to survive through the False Promise. He'll end up popping as Miracle, looking for his own return into Rage.
Oh my God.
Moon hits! So hard, 343 just evaporates. They're keeping inside the sandstorm, so no defensive refraction charge, but it won't matter when Arjit can just run forward like this
Ninja
as well.
Buggy.
Side of it actually up a little bit further, too high, but it won't matter when the root holds Darkseer in position. Triple kill for Ninja Boogie. The only
really
one
well
to survive
played.
Is Ursa.
And that's how you're going to win fights if you're Mineski. They stagger their spell usage, force the Oracle ult, but it's a fight in the river. You get a Fatal Bonds off. The Raging Potato roll forwards. Complexity just have to run away. The Ursa has to be the one initiating if you're going to be able to win engagements. And you can see Moon with that blink just crushes through whatever target he goes for once they're distracted. Really well executed. Ninja Boogie with a triple kill. Even as the hard five, Impetus does not require items to deal as much damage as possible. It's purely based on the distance you are from the target, so.
That does feel a little rough to start, though, for Complexity. Like, Mineski took the most of the opportunity that Limp provided. Like, turning around, not using a defensive Yule Scepter, turning around to try and engage on the
exactly.
TA, but no one else from Complexity were looking to do that.
Yep, and real quick, check out the levels here. This is the problem for Cole. Yeah, the gold difference isn't much, but
14-14?
Yeah, and Limp just hit 12. But the problem is that Ember TA are the heroes that matter for Mineski. The rest are just some sustain, a ton of team fight. But the Ember TA, if you can't take out one of these heroes at the start of the fight, Complexity, you're going to have a real tough time dealing with damage output, these two huge cores. Maelstrom on Ajit, almost a Deso on Moon, who's now just camping, hoping 343 wanders.
If he waited just a second longer, he would have had his opportunity and realizes it now. The TA trap reveals and triggers on 343. Radiant's bottom
tower. Yeah, Complexity just weren't ready. Moon's going to walk into the Ursa of Miracle, but yeah, this is not a hero you go toe-to-toe with. Yep, it's just necessary Complexity get fights like they did in the previous game. They need to be the aggressors. They need to go beeline forwards with an Ion Shelled Ursa, try and get to the Mineski backline, force the rock defensively like they did in that initial team fight around the mid-tier one.
Mm-hmm.
But if Mineski can just play this style, look, five heroes all spread out around the map, presence in every lane, Complexity, you're not feeling confident to make a move towards anywhere.
Yeah, because even when you make the move, you're going to get kited out.
Yeah.
Either you're coming onto the Warlock Rock, but I like the itemization from Enchantress, Ninja Boogie building in for the 4-star, putting all that hard-earned money from the side lanes into that. Then you've got Swashbuckle to get the Pango out. You've got Root. You've got TA traps. And it feels like Miracle, no matter how many break frees he's got, be it in Rage or be it BKB, he won't be able to keep up with the target he's looking to kill.
Yep.
And now, Miracle actually walks in to be that target. Ajit, and get the quick little slow. Enchanting up Miracle. He's protected for the moment thanks to winning Rage, but now it's going to wear off. Another Searing Chains with the follow-up stuns. Ajit will claim the kill, and 42 seconds on the sideline for Miracle opens up Roshan.
Pango's damage output has been insane thus far in the game. I mean, every time he swashbuckles, it feels like half somebody's health disappears, and the team fight he adds as well. As you said, Rosh open, they have the Deso 19 minutes in. And it's just near impossible now, it feels, for Complexity to take fights. You can't run into this lineup of Mineski any longer.
Let's track Illusion. They're smoking up Complexity.
They've got
coming
test, but
yeah, game one, they swung the momentum around by taking a great fight around Roshan. They're going to wrap around the rear. Who are they going to find? There's a root down in mid. Roshan's already been taken into the hands of Moon, so the TA has that secondary life, and they're looking for a fight as Raging Potato looks to create space.
Yep, they just called for out. They know they can't take this engagement. Z-Freak had a
Moon
beat on
it.
KP.
The Observer Sentry sees
blink.
Him. He's revealed. You'll get the blink off. And he's out of dust, out of the effect of dust too.
Yeah, they saw. You just can't fight there because KP is all the way in the back, fighting around Rosh in this game. Much better from Mineski. They have the Warlock, they have the Pango. How are you supposed to run into a choke point as Cole? They need to try and find Mineski split around the map and.
Nope, they're coming in after
that opportunity.
Battle around the 20-minute rune, and maybe
they can bring
him down. This is a huge kill to claim. TP support is coming thick and fast from Mineski, and Complexity are already out. The hit and run they tried to start this game off with, now successful, and they may get another one. Ajip, defensive spirit, up on the hill. Z-Freak's waiting for it, but there is no way to follow up. And in fact, Z-Freak's under the Observer and Sentry, so Ajit again feeling confident to find.
He's under a Sentry.
He's got his own dust underneath two different Sentries. Z-Freak will go for the Burrow Strike, but Double Spirit, and hello! No, he doesn't get it. He doesn't get it. That was Ajit's kill.
Yeah, a bit of misplay there from Z-Freak. should have probably just blinked away immediately, but trying to get cheeky and annoy the Ajit Ember. I'm trying to see, like, there's a Midas on Miracle, there's a Midas on Warlock. The BKB on Miracle, I think, is the real X factor. That will enable him to be surge forwards and just ignore Mineski's lineup effectively, just charge towards the Ench, towards the Warlock. Mm-hmm. You need to take out those heroes of your complexity to start an engagement off if you want to win it. But Mineski, same deal, where they're targeting Limp, the Oracle. It's much easier for them to do so because of that high mobility on their cores. Ember with an Arcane Rune just now fading.
God, defensive observers and sentries need to come up on that hillside if Complexity are going to see Mineski fighting. And now, Slide of Fist, 343 gets clipped by it, but there is no control just yet until the root goes onto Ajit. Z-Freak with a follow-up stun, Golem. And they move forward, but the Golem! Everyone's clicking with the Fatal Bonds! This is huge! Complexity, they're going to evaporate, they have to get back into the shrine, but Ajit's ready to continue this fight on. Moon jumps forward, exploding Z-Freak, but the root in the back line, 343, nowhere to go. Limp has been protected by the False Promise, but it only lasts until now. The Ursa totally stranded, TA trap slowing down Tarvo, Raging Potato for once is actually missing a swashbuckle. The TA traps, any kind of slow, any kind of control, Tavo's still got that high movement speed, but the root, Ajit can keep up with him. Raging Potato jumps in with a shield crush, killing off Tavo, but it's actually Ajit who gets the kill. My god, Mineski are just, their positioning is so good.
Yeah, I love this lineup. And when you see it executed like this, it just makes total sense. Complexity, mm-hmm. They're trying to run at you, pincer you, like just swarm, right?
Yep.
You have an equal number of these cheap disables. Ember with the Searing Chains talent, 4 seconds stun every 8 seconds on potentially two targets. You've got the swashbuckles, TA with the Blink Meld, and then
here,
all
Limp?
The team fight.
What is he doing here?
There are
four
question.
Heroes around him. He's just pushing up the mid lane, and Ninja Boogie will claim his kill.
And Limp's too squishy, 1200 health. Like, he's just getting spammed. He yields himself defensively, sure, sometime in the fight, but there's always going to be a follow-up from Mineski.
You see the facial expression, he's like, what was...
Yeah.
How do you actually handle that as a player as well? Like, you know you get completely caught out. Your team is starting to crumble under the pressure of Mineski. Yep. And the panel was even saying at the very beginning, it's like, I'm trying to understand how Mineski make this work, but you win every single laning phase. You feel solid in your laning phase. And the way they've bounced this around when Warlock goes three, there's no way you could predict that Mineski would have done that.
It feels like the TA is the X factor in a lot of ways, where mm-hmm. you just have this ability to provide vision. Complexity, they don't have those tools. And you can see here, with wards behind the tower, trap under the tower, Tavo's just going to go down here, and Mineski feel confident to just continuously run around. They don't even have the Golem up. It doesn't matter. He'll have Ag soon on KP.
Yep.
And it's just impossible to fight this Mineski lineup anymore. Cole, they don't really have the tools to take the objectives any longer because the Leshrac's unable to get out on the map.
It's such a faster way to play as well from Mineski, where like KP doesn't go the Aura Star build. Like,
yep.
We talk about like the traits that KP has got, but the fact that they've then got the diversity to switch it around, and the mech gets completed over on Pango. Mm. So the extra life is coming from the man they can't even track down anyway.
Four staff on Enchantress as well. Just feels like Cole, relatively one-dimensional aspect to how they have to take fights based on their lineup. It's an Ion Shell on the Ursa. He runs forward. Mm-hmm. Limp goes with him. You hope that Adam, on 343 rather, can stay safe in the back lines on the Oracle. But Mineski, it's so simple for them to just dive forwards, and they're protected by the big ults. Here comes the Epi, though, up top on the TA.
Yep, if they can find it. Here comes Raging Potato as well, looking for the disarm, and just rolling Thunder through the Ursa, keeping on top of Z-Freak. Ursa going to trigger his BKB, but the Spirit's forward, looks to TP out, but he's got more than enough damage to kill off Miracle before that will complete. Yeah, even give him a tip just to like, here's something for your troubles.
He deserves it. He could have BKB TP'd, instead panicked a bit, ran around, and ends up taking too much physical damage. Also, the Ench ultimate, BKB piercing, so much damage. The five position of Mineski, not just saving his TA, but doing half the health pool of Miracle on his...
It feels like the greatest decision they had to do this. Like, I was expecting Complexity's offlane with the Darkseer as well as the SK to be a real, real nuisance. But this Enchantress, you've just felt her presence more than any chance that gets picked. Like, it's just...
It's the different
control.
Hero.
It is a very different hero.
It's not the same.
let me just make my meme.
Yeah, it's fine.
Everyone loves Chad. No one likes Enchantress.
KP's got Ags as soon as the courier's back in base. Actually, an Ags will be the next item on Ajit. And I love it because it's all about finding better initiations and ensuring Cole don't get the jump on you. You're going to have extra remnants, more speed, no mana cost. all of a sudden, Ajit will be able to play everywhere. And you don't have damage problems because the massive team fight. I mean, first off, impetus from the edge. Your five position is outputting more than both Cole supports combined. And then you have the Warlock and the Pango, arguably the best AoE damage control in Dota 2 at the moment. And then a TA with now BKB. How is Limp going to stay alive?
Really darn no. A Greaves at least up for Darkseer, so some extra life will arrive. A Bloodstone charge and buy some space, but if you get fatally bonded, like what happened in the last fight, then it's kind of already over. Like, no matter how much regen you've got, it's not going to get you through it. Not unless every single dispel is able to hit fast on these heroes.
And now we've got, looks like the Ags on the Ember. KP's is up and running as well. And Mineski are ready to rock and roll. I expect them, because they can just poke so well. Spam the slight chains, blink meld, back away, Pango swashbuckle. One hero is going to be at half HP or dead. If you want to engage complexity, somebody's going to be low. And if not, you're just going to have to do what you're doing here, where Mineski slowly whittle down your objective and inevitably clear it out.
All right, Ajit, you brought Dust for this exact reason to catch as you freak out in the side lane. He's still got a spirit in mid lane he can jump over to. So cleaning out the side lane means he can still come back.
And we can expect him to do that momentarily, I believe. Still great vision from Mineski, so aggressive. You can see they're just keeping Cole in the crease of their base. Now you're going to have Pangolier teleporting top. He'll handle that wave as they just try and starve Cole, wait for the next Rosh. That'll most likely be their opportunity to look for a fight to take the game.
Man, how long can Z-Freak do this? Okay, he TP'd out, in fact. I thought he was going to try and creep skip, but he TP'd out for the smoke, the complexity you're going for.
They want to get TA before BKB.
Ember Spirit's already returned to the mid, however.
They need to initiate, but the problem is there's a Warlock behind him, so they're very afraid of that counter initiation and a BKB from Moon.
And second, they planned the Observe Ward down as well. They knew it, because the creep wave's coming in. If it didn't get distracted by the hero, it would have actually just instantly killed the Observer Ward. So the TA traps get triggered.
Uh-oh.
3-4-3 is on the run, and here comes Complexity. Moon jumps in, almost killing 3-4-3-3, and he will with a Sleight of Fist find the kill with the Rock Down. Fatal Bonds will connect him up. A quick Duels Dispel, but it's Limp hitting the deck right on top of Moon, so he's got all the damage he needs. And Miracle starts his run. BKB still surviving, but now he's lost it as well as the Enrage. KP's got the Double Rocks doing the work, and Z-Freak's Epicenter. Oh, it feels like dust on your feet. It is not in your eye. It is too easy for Mineski. Just walk forward, and they will take the mid lane of Rax, and it really feels like they've taken this game.
Yeah, and I think that Mineski just really recovering in the draft in terms of how they game planned. They got Ajit, total free farm. It's not a Morphling. It's not a hero that takes 30 minutes to come online. Ajit was immediately effective once he was level 8, level 9. And they just outfight. You can see they kite Cole. Cole has no method of initiation outside of just running forwards or praying for a random blink. Whereas Mineski, they remnant forwards. Immediately, the Meldrake onto 3-4-3. He dies in a blink of an eye, and then the Golem drops. Cole get just absolutely dismantled. No damage even taken by a Mineski hero. Rosh spawning 24 seconds, but with two racks down, I don't see a way for Cole back into this right now, Tobes.
Yeah, it seems rough. Like I look for Tavo and Z-Freak to be the only ones that can really do it. Like a back into a Barrow Strike, a back into a Practical Ravage, catching Mineski, but they're all